So anyways, welcome back, 32 Degrees of Insanity, 10:05 in the p.m., 12/21/2011. You know, we also bring on our special guest here, Brian Golightly of Australia. Brian is Yahweh. Well, you know, a lot of my listeners are not quite familiar with who you are. You know, you're quite the a hit down there in Australia. A lot of us up here in North America are not familiar with your background. Kind of give us a kind of a brief synopsis of who you think you are or who you know you are.
Well, I'll tell you how it all started. I was 4.848 years old. That's Prince Charles' birthday. Mm-hmm. And a voice spoke to me, and as far as I had no problem with that, I mean, so what? So this voice talks to me and it says, I want you to go and climb the fence next door. And I didn't want to go in there because my mother, she's an unsociable woman, and she's always arguing with the people. So I climbed this picket up to the top of this gate, and then I started to slide down in the palings on the other side, and the splinters got into my toes and fingers. And I'm now impaled on this hardwood fence. And then a hand lifted me off that. And when I looked around, I thought the lady next door must have sprung me getting down off the fence. And there was no one there. And then the voice started talking to me, encouraging me to go through the back of the house and then through the kitchenette, into the kitchen. I still remember, I could do an oil painting of the scene as I'm going through. And into this darkened hallway, and I was a bit scared. I didn't want to get caught by the lady, you see. And very timid boy. So he said, push the door of the bathroom open. So I said, oh, the lady might be in there in the nutty. And he said, no, it's okay, push it. So I pushed it open. And laying on the floor was this lady with her legs slightly apart, dressed down to below her knees. And there was a green and chrome vacuum cleaner that my father had wired up. And I had told him at 4.848 years old that he'd put the wire, that is what we call ground or earth, he put the red wire on that. So she got electrocuted. Behind the door, however, is a little boy, maybe two, maybe not that old. And the voice said, now step over the lady's legs, tell the little boy that the mother's asleep, and take him outside. So I did. And then he said, now go tell your mother. I run to the fence, and now I've got to get up this 6-foot-high fence. Mm-hmm. And I start clawing my way up. Then I feel a hand under me again, lift me to the top. I climb down the lattice work on the other side, tell my mother, but she spots these splinters in the blood on my fingers and toes. And she's going to get a darning needle. So I thought, oh, hell with this. So I'm out of there. Now I go up the fence again, jump down, run around, and the kid, little baby boy's going inside again. So I go in and get him. I lead him out and then close the gauze screen door. And there was a way that these locks I used to use, like a snap spring thing. And I turned it backwards so the little boy couldn't pull the door open. I then go back, and now I scamper up, hand under the backside again, into my mother again. So she's still not listening, and now she's after him to get these needles into me, you see. Well, that wasn't a real happy. So I forgot all about it. So after all this ordeal of getting these splinters out of my fingers and toes, she then is standing in the kitchen looking at the other kitchen. It was like a mirror image housing type arrangement. And she had a hand up to her throat, and she said to me, stay here. She goes in next door and finds that young lady dead. Point is, if she'd listened to me in the first place, the lady would have lived. Now, my father, he had wired up the vacuum cleaner. And from that time onwards, the cruelty from him to me was amazing. So when I got older, he'd say to me things like, you'd argue with Christ, you would. I'd say, you are. Mary appeared to me when I was 6 years of age, took me back in a vision. There were two boys arguing a point in a schoolyard. This is the nuns. They're 9 years old. And one said, Jesus is a Pharisee. And the other one said, no, he wasn't. He's a Sadducee. And I went into a rage. And I rushed up and I was going to fight him. And I said, Jesus, with clenched teeth, Jesus was an Essene. At that point, Mary takes me back in a vision which is more real than me sitting in this room or you sitting in that room right now. And I was sitting on four steps, the top step of this old synagogue, living at a Nazareth. And Joseph had gone inside. And Mary would be 50 feet away or something like that. And she turns, she says, Jesus, Jesus, come. So I rushed up, and I was tired. We'd been coming all the way from Egypt, right? So she said, now, there's something I've got to tell you. So I'm sort of looking at her, and I'm looking back, and Joseph, by this time, I started to walk out of the, with two little men, rabbis, had his hand, a very big man, had his arms around them, embracing, I hadn't seen him for so long. And she said, now, if the Jews find out that we're Essenes, they will kill us, so you must never say nothing. And then that was the end of the vision. Walking out that afternoon, I looked up from the nuns, and I looked up, what I used to do is save the penny tram fare and buy my mother a present. And so I would just walk home or run home. Very, very funny stories about that. I should tell you later on. But anyway, I looked up to heaven and I said, well, God, I know you can't be here for some reason. You tell me and I'll tell the world. Thank you very much. And I went home. Very profound for a boy of that age to think that way and having had that effect. So from that point onwards, the information has been pouring down into my soul. And of course, I always tell the truth and always